You see, all of these things are gifts from God. So it's not about earning them. It's not about doing some course. It's not about... all it is about is just receiving the gift from God. They come out of our relationship with God as we talk to Him and as we listen to Him, as we are at work. And yes, we're working, but we're working with our spiritual ear open to God all the time. When we're walking down the street, when we're with family, wherever we are, we have our spiritual ear open to God all the time. Amen? And into that, we find God speaking.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called You Are Gifted, Part 2, 1 Corinthians 12, verses 1 to 11, by Pastor David Wise.
We're going to do a brief recap, first of all, of last week. Then I'm going to do some teaching. Then unusually, we're going to follow the same pattern as we did last week, which isn't our usual pattern in the teaching, is that after I finish teaching, whatever time that is, we're going to have an opportunity for prayer ministry. And we're going to pray for probably for most of you, perhaps not all of you, but we're going to pray for most of you during that time. So that's where we're going this morning. So let me introduce, first of all, we here, you and me, we are called to reach out to those around about us. We're called to be Jesus to them. You know, where is the body of Christ today?
We are.
Okay. And we use that expression, don't we, of the church? We say, it is the body of Christ. Well, that means that actually it's Jesus. It's Jesus to the people. So if people round about us want to find Jesus, we are that demonstration, aren't we? Amen? Didn't sound too sure about that, some of you. We are the body of Christ. We are Jesus. We are called to minister to the people we meet. We're called to be channels of God to work through. So people you meet in the street, people you meet at college, people you meet in your family, at work, on the bus, in the tube, wherever it is you happen to be, your neighbours, your friends, your enemies, you are called to be channels for God to work through into their lives. Amen? Do you believe that? We have a prophetic group in the church here called Envision. They meet once a month on a Sunday evening. And when they met recently, they met in this area here. And they saw a picture on this platform. And it was a picture of water flowing off the platform. Some of you will know, you can find it on our website, that we had a well here for some time. And we had water coming out of that. And this was the image that they saw of water coming off of the platform here, and saw people coming and taking cups and scooping up that water and then going out of the building with that water. And it was an image, as Liz, who's the leader of Envisioned, was there. She said that she felt God was saying that we, Greenford Baptist Church, need to stir up the gifts within us, not for our benefit, not so that we have a great time, but so that we can minister to the community around us. Shortly after that, at Men Behaving Godly, our men's discipleship group, a man who was visiting that evening, he prayed the following: I can see that there are gifts already at work, but I feel that you need to fan the flames of those gifts. I see a strong river flowing out of here, connecting the gifts with getting out into the community. We felt that was a confirmation of what God was saying to us. Hence this teaching last week and this week. I believe, and we're going to look at this in the scripture again in a moment, but I believe and am convinced that God has given every single one of you here in this room or listening to this on the internet, every single one of you who knows Jesus, God has gifted. God has given you gifts, gifts in your life. Not for your benefit, not so that you have a nice life, though God does want to bless you, but actually so that you can bless other people. 2 Timothy 1 verse 6 and 7 says this: "For this reason I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity, but of power and of love and of self-discipline." Let's stand together, shall we? I want to commit this time together to God. Father God, as we stand here before you this morning, we open ourselves to you. I'd invite you just to maybe to put your hands out in front of you. Father, we stand here before you this morning and we invite you afresh into our lives. Father God, we don't want to be the same when we leave here as we are at this moment in time. We want an impartation of your Spirit, a release of your gifts. We want those things that are within us to be fanned into flame here this morning so that we can reach out, we can minister to the people we're going to meet tomorrow morning at work, tomorrow afternoon, our neighbours. When we're collecting the kids from school at the school gate tomorrow, the people that we talk to, when we're on the bus tomorrow, the people around us. Father God, we want to be the place where heaven meets earth for these people. We want to be the place where your Spirit flows through and makes a difference in people's lives. And Father, we invite you now, in this next hour or so that we're together, to work powerfully in our lives. Jesus' name. Amen. Please sit down. If you turn, please, to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And let me read to you. I'm not going to go through the same teaching that I did last week, so if you're here and you want to hear the rest of the first part of this in detail, you'll find it on our website. You can listen to it later today or at any time, day or night during the week. Now about spiritual gifts, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1. "Brothers, I do not want you to be ignorant. You know that when you were pagans, somehow or another you were influenced and led astray to mute idols. Therefore, I tell you that no one who is speaking by the Spirit of God says, 'Jesus be cursed.' And no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord,' except by the Holy Spirit. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but the same God works all of them in all men. Now, to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good." Now, we did this last week. We're going to do this again together. We're going to read this verse together, but instead of each one, you're going to put your name. Because if it's true for each one, it's true for you. Amen? Amen? So this is about you. This verse is about you. It is about everyone else in the room here, but actually, it's about you. It's about you. So let's make this personal. Let's read verse 7 together. And where it says each one, you say your name. Ready? "Now, to David, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good." Let's say that together. Let's stand together. Let's proclaim it. I want you to turn around and look at somebody else when you say this, because this is a proclamation of what is true. And I don't want you just to be saying this into the air, okay? You can look at more than one person at the moment. That's okay. You know, that's fine. Are you ready? Now, to David, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. Amen.
Amen.
Please sit down. Now, if you're a visitor here, I ask questions when we're working through the material. So just to explain that when I ask questions, we're going to talk together. Now, if that is true, which it is, isn't it? Because it's God's word. What does that mean? We looked at some of this last week, but what does that mean for us in our lives this week? So we're not asking a hypothetical question about, you know, when we go to know Jesus better and we're more holy and we've done some more study and we've done this, done that and the other. What does this mean for you, mean for us tomorrow? In whatever it is, think about what you're doing tomorrow, where you're going. What does this verse mean for you tomorrow? In wherever you're going to be. Just say where you're going to be tomorrow, and then what does this verse for you mean there? Is that okay? Any volunteers? Well, I'll pick on a few people. If you're not part of the leadership, you're safe from being picked on, by the way. Just to say that to you, if you're a visitor, don't think, oh, he's going to pick on me. But if you're part of the leadership, you're fair game, so as far as I'm concerned. Susan?
For me, it's...
Where are you going to be tomorrow?
I'll be with David, I'll be with Amy, and I'll be several places. So therefore,
okay.
I must let the Holy Spirit speak through me.
So the people you see, you're a carer for Amy, so with her and other people, you must let the Spirit speak through you,
yes.
Wherever you are. Very good. Anybody else? Caleb.
I start a training course tomorrow, so it's my first day, and for me, it's sort of like going into that room and maybe people seeing something different in me than the normal people that they would...
Okay, so seeing Jesus in you, because you are the temple of the Holy Spirit. You are the place where heaven touches earth. And as you go in that room, you take Jesus with you. Boss A.
The Spirit that will be with me to help me with the questions and...
Okay, so the Spirit to work through you. Very good. Boss A.
I work with very young children. I want the children to feel loved. To feel Jesus' love through me.
Okay, so with the children you're going to be with, working with tomorrow, you want... Jesus' love to come through you,
yeah,
through the power of the Spirit. Very good. Anybody else? Mark.
Yeah, I just wanted to get a few problems tomorrow. Gary, just got me possessed you today. And I've had them round, I've sent emails and to the MP. And I've got them in a temporary hostel. I'm going to be working and trying to... getting rehoused, let them know that God's working in his life.
Okay. So how is God... So you're seeing this guy tomorrow. This guy has been evicted. You've just got him rehoused in temporary accommodation. So how is God going to work through you? What are you looking for God to do for you tomorrow in that context?
I've let him know that God is working for him and the fact that he's been rehoused.
Okay. So for him to be able to see God working in his situation, yes, through you. Excellent. Very good. Very good. Okay, let's explore this a bit more together as we go into this. Verse 8. To each one there is given through the Spirit the message of wisdom, to another the message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by that one Spirit, to another miraculous powers, to another prophecy, to another distinguishing between spirits, to another speaking in different kinds of tongues, and to still another the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he gives them to each one just as he determines. Now, last week, I worked through these verses. We looked at the gifts listed here. We looked at the gifts listed at two other places in the New Testament, and I did a brief explanation of each of them. I'm not going to repeat that today. What we're going to do today... So we're going to look in more depth at three of the gifts. There are nine in this list here in 1 Corinthians 12. And we're going to have a slightly more in-depth look at three. And then we're going to pray to see those three gifts specifically, but the other gifts in general, released through us into the community. Okay? That's where we're going. All right with that? That's what we're going to do anyway, but, you know, it's nice if you if you're happy with where we're going, because we're still going there. So, let's look, first of all, at these two. The message of wisdom and the message of knowledge. It's there in verse 8. So, the first question is, what is it? Well, this is about information supernaturally revealed. Not just about bald facts. Now, the word of knowledge is often used in healing in evangelistic contexts. And that's a valid use for it, but it's a bit limited. You know, you may be at work, and, you know, Richard might be in some context, and God may say to, I'm just picking on you because you're in the front row, but this might happen to you tomorrow, Richard. You'll be at work, and God may say to you, that person over there, okay, they've got this physical thing that is wrong with them, and I want you now to go and pray for them and ask God to heal them. And you go over them and say, whatever the person's name is, have you got this wrong with you? And they will say, how did you know that? God showed me. I want to pray for you. So it's often used in that sort of context. But it actually is much bigger and much wider than that. It's not just bald facts, but it's insight into God's purposes, insight into God's plans, insight into God's strategy. So we're going to look at some verses. I'm going to read to you, first of all, some verses from Ephesians. And then we're going to look at some examples of these things in practice. You might want to note these verses down, look at them in more detail later. The ones, all the examples, the verses will actually be up on the screen. We'll make it easier for you to write them down. But turn with me to Ephesians. And let's see something about this gift on a wider canvas, on a bigger picture. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. It's page 1173, if you're still hunting for it. I get excited every time I read these verses. Oh. I keep asking that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the glorious Father, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that you may know him better. I pray also that the eyes of your heart may be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which he's called you, the riches and the glorious inheritance of the saints, and his incomparably great power for those who believe. That power is like the working of his mighty strength. Oh, God wants you to see that. Now, so often as Christians, we wander through life. We're sort of looking down like this, you know. This is what God wants us to see. Remember that story that John Noble told the other day? He was preaching here a few weeks ago. He was in a Christian bookshop. You may remember him saying he doesn't like Christian bookshops. He doesn't like all the texts and everything else. And he picked up this card, which just caught his attention. And it said, look down. What? You know, we're always being told as Christians to keep looking up. It said, look down. I opened it up and said, because you are seated in the heavenly places with Christ. That's one aspect here we see. Eyes, just turn over the page, chapter 3, verse 17. Oh, I get excited about these verses as well. I just get excited, that's the trouble, but I mean some bits, anyway. So that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have the power together with all the saints. And this is wisdom at work here. To grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know that this love surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of the fullness of God. Amen! Amen. Whoa. Supernatural revelation, not just of information, bald facts, but including insight into God's purposes. We want to see some of that released in our lives, don't we? Yes. Let's look at some examples in the Bible. Each of these, the way I'm going to work through, is one from the Old Testament, one from Jesus, and then some others from the New Testament. There are loads and loads we could pick on. But here's a few. So we're looking, first of all, here, some examples of wisdom at work. We're going to start in Genesis chapter 41. As I say, there are literally dozens and dozens that we could pick on, but I've just chosen a few representative samples. Genesis 41, it's page 45. It's actually page 46, the bit that I'm going to read. And it's the story of Joseph. I haven't got time to tell you the whole story, but Joseph has been in prison, not through his own fault. He finds himself with Pharaoh. He finds himself, Pharaoh's had some dreams that have troubled him. And through a series of things that God sets up, he finds himself interpreting these dreams for Pharaoh. And so the dreams are about what's going to happen. 7 years of plenty and then 7 years of famine. And then Joseph says this, and this is wisdom at work. And now, let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt. And let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all of the food of those good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. And this food should be held in reserve for the country to be used during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt so that the country may not be ruined by the famine. The plan seemed good to Pharaoh and his officials. And Pharaoh said to them, "Can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God? Since God has made all this known to you," says Pharaoh, "there is no one so discerning as wise as you. You shall be in charge." God's wisdom, the message of wisdom working through Joseph. Let's jump all the way forward to Matthew. Matthew chapter 22, just one example, because you see, most of these spiritual gifts, there are two exceptions for reasons that I'll go into perhaps on another occasion, but you'll see seven of these nine gifts at work in Jesus' ministry. And here's an example here, Matthew 22, verse 15. It's page 990. The Pharisees went out and laid plans to trap Jesus in his words. They sent their disciples to him along with the Herodians. "A teacher," they said, "we know that you are a man of integrity and you teach the word of God in accordance with the truth. You aren't swayed by men because you pay no attention to who they are." "Well then," as they chuckled to themselves thinking, "we've got him now, tell us, what is your opinion? Is it right to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" And they thought, "we've got him now." Because if he says, "pay taxes to Caesar," the crowd will stone him. If he says, "don't pay taxes to Caesar," the Romans will arrest him. Brilliant. Curveball, we've got him sorted. Jesus, knowing their evil intent, said, "You hypocrites, why are you trying to trap me? Show me the coin used for paying the tax." They brought him a denarius, and he said, "whose portrait is this and whose inscription?" "Caesar's," they replied, and here's the wise answer. "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's, and give to God what is God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they went away. God's wisdom at work. See it in the New Testament, Acts chapter 6. Going to look just at two examples, Acts 6 and verse 8. "Now Stephen, a man full of God's grace and power, did great wonders and miraculous signs among the people. Opposition arose, however, from members of the synagogue of freedmen, as it was called, Jews of Cyrene and Alexandria, as well as the provinces of Cilicia and Asia. These men began to argue with Stephen, but they could not stand up against his wisdom or the spirit by whom he spoke." Another very different example, Acts 27. The context here is that Paul is on a boat. He's a prisoner. He's on his way to Rome. Huge storm. Storm's been running for days. and they're being driven before this storm. The sailors spot that they're heading towards land, and it looks like the boat's going to be wrecked, and they're all going to die. And this is what happens in chapter 27 and verse 30. In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. And Paul said to the centurion and the officers, "Unless those men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." So the soldiers cut the ropes that held the lifeboat and let it fall away. And just before dawn, Paul urged them all to eat. "For the last 14 days, that's how long the storm has been going, you've been in constant suspense. You have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head." And after he said this, he took some bread, gave thanks to God in front of them all. Then he broke it and began to eat. They were all encouraged and ate some food themselves. There were 276 people on board. And after they'd eaten as much as they wanted, they lightened the ship by throwing the grain into the sea, and so on and so on. And the fact is, they were all saved. Not one was killed. But it was the wisdom that God had given to Paul that spoke into that context and situation. Let's look at some biblical examples of the word of knowledge at work. And again, just four examples. First one, Old Testament. 2 Kings chapter 5 and verse 19. "I hope when you're looking at these and listening to these, you recognize that you have got in you the same Holy Spirit that did these things." Amen? So there is, and these are just generally fairly ordinary people that God's Spirit came upon. Like you. Hello, who's ordinary here? You're all candidates for God to work through. Because His Spirit working in you means you can do extraordinary things in the power of His Spirit. Here's one in the, again, there are so many I could have chosen, but 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 19. Some people had come to Elijah. He'd prayed with them. Naaman had been healed from leprosy, and Elisha had dismissed them, had declined to take any gifts from them, and had sent them with his blessing. "Go in peace," Elisha said. After Naaman, who is the one who'd been healed, had travelled some distance, Gehazi, the servant of Elisha, the man of God, said to himself, "My master was too easy on Naaman, this Aramean, by not accepting from him what he brought. As surely as the Lord lives, I will run after him and get something from him." So Gehazi hurried after Naaman. When Naaman saw him running towards him, he got down. He said, "Is everything okay?" "Everything is okay," Gehazi answered. "But my master sent me to say, 2 young men from the company of the prophets have just come to me from the hill country of Ephraim. Please give them a talent of silver and 2 sets of clothing." "By all means, take 2 talents," said Naaman. He urged Gehazi to accept them. He tied up 2 talents of silver in 2 bags, 2 sets of clothing, gave them to 2 of his servants. They carried them. There's a lot of stuff here, okay? Took 2 servants to carry it. Right? We're not talking about a couple of coins here and a change of underpants. You know, we're talking here about substantial gift. Just thought we'd make that clear so you understand what happens at the end of the story. Gehazi took them. Servants carried them ahead. Gehazi came to the hill. He took the things from the servants, put them in the house, sent the men away. They left and went in and stood before Elisha. "Where have you been, Gehazi?" Elisha asked. "Your servant didn't go anywhere," Gehazi answered. Elisha said to him, "Was not my spirit with you when the man got down from his chariot to meet you? Is this the time to take money or to accept clothes, olive groves, vineyards, flocks, herds, or men servants and maidservants? Naaman's leprosy will cling to you and your descendants forever." Gehazi went out from Elisha's presence, and he was leprous, as white as snow. John chapter 4. It's Jesus. John chapter 4, verse 17. Jesus is talking with a Samaritan woman. And he says to her, go call your husband. I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, supernaturally revealed knowledge, you have had five husbands, and the man you have now is not your husband. What you've just said is quite true. Verse 29. Come and see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Acts chapter 5. Ananias and Sapphira. I told this story last week. We're not going to read it all the way through. It's verse 1 to 11. Ananias sold some land, kept some money for himself, which he was perfectly entitled to do, but brought what was left to the church and said, here is all the money. And Peter said, verse 3, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit? Ananias died, as did his wife when she also lied. God's Spirit to Peter revealed the truth. Let's look at a very different example, chapter 10 and verse 19. Again, there are many in Acts. Peter's up on his roof, thinking. And the Spirit said to him, Simon, it makes me smile, actually. It's almost like the Spirit saying, Simon, wake up. No. Three men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. So here, it's not just the Spirit saying, you know, there are people downstairs, Simon, but actually, I've sent these people, you go with them. It's the word or the message of knowledge. So we see it, both of these, and they're linked together. It's very hard sometimes to draw a boundary, say which is which, and it doesn't actually matter. These are just descriptions of the way that God works. But how do we use it? This is what it is. How do we use it? Well, it is actually very easy. You see, all of these things are gifts from God. So it's not about earning them. It's not about doing some course. It's not about... all it is about is just receiving the gift from God. They come out of our relationship with God as we talk to Him and as we listen to Him, as we are at work. And yes, we're working, but we're working with our spiritual ear open to God all the time. When we're walking down the street, when we're with family, wherever we are, we have our spiritual ear open to God all the time. Amen? And into that, we find God speaking. And in some situations, we're facing a situation and we just don't know what to do. And the Bible says, James 1:5, if any of you lacks wisdom, ask God. So in those situations, we ask God and we listen to God. And God speaks to us and God guides us. Now it is important, as with all of these gifts, that we let things rest in our spirit for a while. We make sure that there is a sense of peace of God's Spirit with us. Sometimes we need to test these things out. This morning, as somebody came forward to be prayed for here, I was over here and I felt God speak to me about that person. But before I actually said anything to them, Liz was praying with them and I said to Liz, I just felt God say this. What do you think? She said, well, actually, I felt God say this. So what God's given you is part two of what God's given me. So there is that confirmation there. And so sometimes we need to do that. We need to ask a brother or a sister. But we also need to remember that all of these gifts are about serving other people. Not about bigging ourselves up. Not about drawing attention to ourselves. Not about actually getting one over on anybody else. They're serving other people, motivated by love. So here's the question on this before we look at the third one. So we've done two, we'll look at the third one in a moment. What does this look like? As you use this gift, or as we use these gifts in the community around about us, whatever that community and place is, what does this look like in action? What might God be wanting to happen through you, through us? What are you looking for God to do through you in the context of these gifts in your situation?
Change their lives.
Okay, for God to speak through you to change people's lives. Yeah. Might want to pray for people for healing. Yeah. We're going to talk about healing in just a moment. Yeah.
You might need to take a practical option. You may have something and it may be you need to do something practical quietly just to do it. It may not occur to you to do it naturally, but you may do it.
Okay, so it may be God giving you some practical instruction that this is something that needs doing,
yeah.
That you just need to put your hands to and you need to just quietly get on and do it. Yeah. What else? Joan?
I think most of all, it's showing them that God is concerned in their lives.
Yeah. Yeah, it shows people that God is concerned. Going back to the example that I made up with Richard, you know, if that happened with Richard at work, as Richard went and said to that person and prayed for them, they're going to know there is a God that cares about me so much that he sent his servant to come and pray for me. So yeah, it's demonstrating that God cares about people. What else?
And it's also even ourselves put open to God to direct us in which way he wants to use us.
So in whatever we are, we need to be open to God for him to direct us, to use us, yeah. You know, when we're doing... We're going to be involved in the Green for Carnival this year. We're looking at doing it a bit differently this year. We're looking at seeing these sorts of gifts being used through us as we meet people at the carnival. Amen? When we're doing door-to-door work around here, when we're knocking on doors and asking people, is there anything you'd like us to pray for? We're doing that on a regular basis. Evangelism team are out quite often, doing stuff in Greenford Broadway. We're looking for God to speak into our lives about the people that we're meeting. Amen? Amen?
Amen? Amen.
Let's look at the third of these this morning. Gifts of healing. Well, what is it, first of all? Healing formed a major part of Jesus' ministry. In fact, if you... I haven't done this, but I've read in a book someone else who has done it. If you go through the Gospels and you just look at how much of the text in the Gospels and what it's about, one quarter of the Gospels are about healings. Formed the major part of Jesus' ministry. But it is much more than just physical healing. It includes emotional healing, mental healing, spiritual healing. Supernaturally, in all of these things, God does heal people naturally. There is a process of natural healing. But this is about supernatural healing that goes outside the normal laws of science and physics. And there was a comment somebody related to me this week that had appeared, I think it was on the BBC website, when there was some miracle that was described. Basically, it was saying, you know, there are the laws of nature, miracles don't happen! Exclamation mark. You know, well, actually, I think they've missed the point because the laws of nature just describe the way that God normally does things. Well, that's the way that God normally does things. God can do what he likes. He doesn't, you know, do things the way that he normally does things. So this is about supernatural healing, healing in ways that go outside the normal way. So let's look just... again, at some examples of these. We mentioned Naaman already, so that'll do for our Old Testament one. In the Gospels, there are 27 different separate healings recorded. And I'm not going to read any of those because they're all familiar to you. So let's look at some in the church, Acts chapter 3. And I want you to watch these closely. And think about what is happening and where it's happening. Okay? What it's happening and where it's happening. And we're going to look at 1, 2, 3, 4. Acts chapter 3. There are others as well, but we're just going to look at 4. Acts chapter 3. This is the verses 1 down to 10. Peter and John were going into the temple. The time of prayer, 3 in the afternoon. It's a man, crippled from birth, being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. And Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them something. So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I give you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet, he began to walk. Then he went with him into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. And when all the people saw him walking and praising God, they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened. Turn over the page, chapter 5, verse 12. The apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders among the people, and all the believers used to meet together in Solomon's colonnade. No one else dared join them, even though they were highly regarded among the people. Nevertheless, more and more men and women believed in the Lord and were added to their number. And as a result, people brought the sick into the streets, laid them on beds and mats, so that at least Peter's shadow might fall on some of them as he passed by. Crowds also gathered from the towns of Jerusalem, bringing their sick and those tormented by evil spirits. And all of them were healed. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. When those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went, Philip went down to a city in Samaria, proclaimed the Christ there. When the crowds heard Philip and saw the miraculous signs he did, they all paid close attention to what he said. Get that? When they heard him and saw, they paid close attention. With shrieks, evil spirits came out of many. Many paralytics and cripples were healed. There was great joy in the city. Chapter 9, verse 32. As Peter travelled around the country, he went to visit the saints in Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas, a paralytic who'd been bedridden for 8 years. "Aeneas," Peter said to him, "Jesus Christ heals you. Get up and tidy up your mat." Immediately Aeneas got up, and all those who lived in Lydda and Sharon saw him and turned to the Lord. And so on, and so on, and so on. So what do you notice about them? What do you notice about him? Warren?
It's outside.
It's outside. It's not in the church meetings.
No.
It's not people coming to the front and being prayed for.
Right.
So it's
out there.
Outside. Outside. And what happens when people see that stuff outside? I know this is obvious, but let's just remind ourselves what happens. People are amazed. They turn to Jesus. They turn to the Lord. That's the context. That's the place. There is a place for people, for sick Christians being prayed for, anointed with oil, the elders in the church laying hands on them. I'm not saying that isn't biblical. It is. It's talked about in James. But the context of the gift of healing that's listed in there in 1 Corinthians 12 is not about doing that in church. It is about being church outside, in the community. How do we use it? There's something very important to notice about Jesus' healing ministry. Every single person he prayed for was healed. But he didn't pray for every sick person. You can see an example of it. You can read it later if you like in John chapter 5. The first 9 verses. Jesus went to this place and there were, if my memory is correct, there were hundreds of sick people there. How many did Jesus heal? One. Now, I don't know why he didn't heal more than one, but he just healed one. As he went around Palestine, there were sick people everywhere. Everyone he prayed for was healed. He did not pray for everyone. And there's a principle here. It's all to do with the way that the kingdom of God works and the kingdom of God in our lives. And this is not a morning for going through and explaining all of that. But the key that we need to take hold of here is listening to God. It's listening to God. What do you want to do in this situation? What do you want to do in this situation? And then as we hear God speaking to us, we get on and do it. So here's the question. In our context, in our situation around us, what might this look like in practice? What might it look like at Greenford Carnival? When we're going door to door, what might it look like? This is not a difficult question. This is not a difficult question. This is about engaging, actually, our imagination with what God is saying to us. I'm glad you're here.
Would it just be that you ask people if they want prayer for anything? We're not just going to say to someone, you know, I'm just going to pray for you. And
we always need to ask people's permission before we pray for people. Like that, absolutely.
But for specific things.
Yeah. So maybe, you know, God speaking to us and showing us situations. We hear God saying and saying, can I pray for you? You should always ask that question, by the way. You should never just assume. You should always ask. What else? Come on, people. Warren, I'm going to pick on you because I know this is a passion for you. Which is why you're finding it hard to talk about it. It's yes. Not because you've got nothing to say. You've got so much to say.
It's seeing people released. People having released from the oppression they're having. Having the things that are suppressing and oppressing them, be it an illness, be it demons, be it, because that does exist. Even yeah,
absolutely.
It is seeing that it's released from people, that coming out of people, seeing God's power completely release them to reveal God to them.
Absolutely. Okay. Which is about our motto for this year. Our church motto. This links back into our church motto. If you haven't read it recently, go back to it. Read it. Read the verses around it. It's about seeing release for captives. Physical captives, spiritual captives, mental captives. Release for captives. It's God's heart. We want to see more of that. Okay, we're going to spend a bit of time listening to God and responding to God. If you weren't here last Sunday morning, could you stand, please? If you weren't here last Sunday morning, could you stand? Sorry? If you were not here last Sunday morning, if you'd stand. Okay. So those of you sitting down were here last Sunday morning. And you were prayed for, yeah? Amen? Okay, look at the people round about you. Because you're going to pray for them now as you were prayed for last Sunday. And you're going to pray for God's Spirit to be released in their lives. You're going to pray that the gifts that are within them are stirred up and released. Amen? Amen. So let's do it. Everyone else, stand up. All of these people that are standing initially, make sure you have at least one person praying with each. And let's call on God. Let's see God's Spirit break out. Let's see those gifts fanned into flame in these people's lives. Amen? Amen. Let's do it. Come on. Pour out your Spirit, Lord. Pour out your Spirit, Lord. Pour out your Spirit, Lord. Fan into flame those gifts, Father God. Fan into flame those gifts. See your Spirit released. Let's see your Spirit released. Fan into flame. Rekindle the fire. Rekindle the fire. See these gifts released in people's lives. See an outbreak of God. See an outbreak of God here. You feel God speaking to you for the person you're praying for, then just say that out over them. Prophesy over them. See God's Spirit released here. See God's Spirit released. Father God, release your spirit, Lord. Release your spirit. Fan into flame. Now, if when I was talking this morning about seeing God's gift of healing released in an evangelistic context, you found yourself really excited about that. You just felt your spirit saying, I really want to see that happening through me. Not you want to see it in general in the church, or yeah, it'd be great to see it at Greenford Carnival, or wonderful, but you felt this, yeah, I really want to see that. Father God, I want to see that released. Could you just go and stand in this area at the back here? The back's bigger than the front. Could you just make your way and just go and stand in that space at the back there? You do that? You felt, yeah, this is something. Really felt, this is something I want to see. Just quickly, don't spend a long time thinking about it. You either, it is or it isn't.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020-8575-5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.